My history with the project, I started this mainly as a collection of snippets from the SciPy mailing list from my own PhD work. That was done sort of in the field of super resolution imaging. Stephen worked more in radar, LIDAR, and Josh here is more into the medical image processing side of things. Although we all dabble a little bit in various different fields. I'm sure we've got a handful of astronomers, we've got some neuroimaging people. Image processing is one of those fields that kind of covers the whole gamut of science. And just a fantastically rich source of data. And wonderful what you can do when you process that data carefully. So as we have many or people from many different fields in the audience, I'm sure we've got people from with different levels of expertise. So we're going to try and keep all of you busy, and we're going to sort of, I hope that we can push the limits of what you know today a little bit, but I think we're going to sort of take an average pace. If you ever feel we're going too slowly or too quickly, just let us know and we can try and adapt. So today's tutorial is divided into four parts. The first part is just an introduction that I'll be giving now. We'll cover a bit about, we'll talk a little bit about how scikit-image represents images, how it uses NumPy arrays to do so, what the dimensions and the data types are that are involved, etc. And then we're basically immediately going over into interactive examples mode. So Stephen will do a discussion on segmentation, which is something that comes up fairly often in most fields. And then Josh is going to do an extensive example on how to stitch image panoramas. So there we'll see a little bit of image warping, of feature detection, and of how to match images together, and how to eradicate seams that would form when you put the images together. And then the last part of the tutorial, we left fairly freeform. We've got a whole bunch of different examples and exercises you can try, and so you can choose which of the many ones you want to do. And I've even got a little competition there at the end waiting for you. Then I wanted to mention that on Saturday and Sunday, we'll be doing the sprint. So at the end of every SciPy conference, we've got 2 days where a whole bunch of people get together to hack on these projects, to work on improving the different packages. And we could use all of your help. It doesn't matter what your level of expertise is. Everything from documentation to websites to including or implementing new features or reviewing code, everyone's welcome. We normally have a blast. All right. And maybe just a quick word on how scikit-image fits in with the rest of the Python environment or the scientific Python ecosystem. So NumPy lies at the foundation of basically all the scientific packages, so that's just the array object that we use to represent, in our case, images. On top of NumPy, you've got SciPy, which implements more advanced scientific routines. And we also rely on SciPy for example, our interpolation routines, for some of the warping routines. That's all located in SciPy's ND image module. There are other packages that can work along with scikit-image. So scikit-learn, for example, if you want to do machine learning combined with image processing, then scikit-learn is perfect. OpenCV is another very popular tool. I'd say a slightly less Pythonic interface, but excellent if you have to do real-time type work. So if you have, for example, a factory setting where you have to take a video and process it in real-time, OpenCV is an excellent candidate. Also BSD licensed, so you can look at the code and integrate it in scikit-image as you will. And then sort of, this is actually a sub-part of scikit-image, but it's the scikit-image novice module, and I just wanted to mention it. We developed this in collaboration with Software Carpentry, and those of you, I don't know who would know this, but do some of you remember the logo language? Turtle graphics? Yeah, so that was like one of the first things I saw when I got involved with computers is you get a little turtle on the screen. You can say go forward so many times, go to the right, and you've got a pen that you can put down. You can draw pretty images. So we've got sort of a turtle graphics-like module for teaching in scikit-image. All right, so for orienting yourself, it's important to be aware of at least three resources. The first is our gallery, the second is the scikit-image user guide, and the third is the API reference. So the gallery is a collection of examples that give you a fairly good overview of what scikit-image can do. If you click on any single example, then you will get a bit of a text description of what happens there. You'll get some output images, and you'll get a piece of code that reproduces that output. And you can just copy this code, execute it directly in your own notebook or in your own IPython shell, and you should see the same image produced on your system. So that's a good way to discover the package. If you click on documentation, so this is all on scikit-image.org, scikit-image.org. So if you go to the website and you click on documentation, it takes you to this page, and there you will see the two other links I mentioned, the API reference and the user guide. So the user guide gives you sort of an overarching explanation of some of the concepts underlying scikit-image, like how do we represent images and so forth, but we're going to cover that in this tutorial. And then the API reference is basically an extended list of functionality available. And you can click on any given function, and you will get a doc string that describes to you the inputs, the outputs, and often you'll see a few examples in there that you can execute as well. Right, the handout we gave, that presents a brief outline of the submodules of scikit-image. So that would be mainly the headings of the API reference, and then it highlights a couple of commonly used functions. All right, so any questions so far? Shall we go ahead and get our hands dirty? Yep. Good. So, like I said, the first part of the tutorial is mainly going to be about how scikit-image represents images. And the underlying concept is very simple. In scikit-image, images are only NumPy arrays. There's nothing special. There's no strange object around it. It's simply a NumPy array. So, let's get this back. All right. So, first thing, with all these notebooks, you'll see a few commands at the top. That's just basically to give us Python 2 and 3 compatibility. How many people here are still running Python 2? Okay, so quite a few. So be sure you execute that first cell. And maybe I'm also going to ask that we just do a check that everyone can do import scikit-image successfully. And if you can't, then just put up your hand so that one of these guys can come and give you a hand. So if you've successfully imported scikit-image, just give me an indication. Just raise your hand so I can see. All right, so I'm going to give you all a few seconds just to make sure that works.
So is this a notebook that was in the repository?
Yeah. So the I should just mention that so the repository looks like this. And you should launch the IPython notebook from the root of the repository. So make sure this is your working directory. No, that's not the right one. There we go. This one. So that's the root of the repository you cloned. So just go to that directory in the terminal and type ipython notebook, or if you're using a different launcher, make sure that's the home directory. And then you navigate to lectures, no, to 2015 SciPy and index. That's the page I had open. And if you scroll down, you'll find the schedule with the links to the different notebooks. So who was not able to find this notebook? Just give an indication. Stephen will give you a hand. You have to do a pull from this morning, yeah. So just make sure that you update the repository to the latest version. I made some tweaks last night still. All right, so if you've gotten to the point where you can import SK image successfully, you're good to go. If not, please put up your hand and I'll come and assist you. Right. Yeah, so if you've got the notebook, you should have this available. Just open it up in your browser and you should be able to scroll back and forth as you want. Right, so like I said, images in scikit-image are just simple NumPy arrays. So let's generate our first image. So what I'm going to do here is I'm importing NumPy as NP, that's the standard convention, import PLT, so Matplotlib, the Matplotlib PyPlot module we import as PLT. And just for simplicity, change this. Okay, so then I'm going to generate a random image. So I'm going to use NumPy's random functionality, generate a 500 by 500 square image. NumPy's random module, it gives me back random values between what and what? 0 and 1, yeah. So I'm just generating a square matrix of values between 0 and 1, and then I'm asking Matplotlib to visualize it. Hey guys, good morning. Grab a handout on your way in. So there we have it. So simple grayscale image, 500 by 500 values between 0 and 1. It works roughly the same for real-world images. So scikit-image has a submodule called data, and data just contains a bunch of example images. So in this case, I'm going to import the data submodule and then grab the coins image, which is available as data.coins, and then I'm going to print some parameters of that image and visualize it. So there you see a real-world image. And what did I ask? I asked, what is the type of coins? And you can see that it's just a NumPy array. And I asked, what's its data type? In this case, the data type was an unsigned integer of 8 bits, so values between 0 and 255. And it has a shape of 300 rows and 384 columns. So that's for gray-level images. And then for color images, we have a similar situation. So here I grabbed data.chelsea, so Chelsea's my cat, and there you see the shape of the cat image, 300 by 451 by 3. So why do we have three layers here?
RGB,
yeah, so we need a red, a green, and a blue component, and that's what's provided to us here. Again, this array is of type uint8 or unsigned byte, so we get values between 0 and 255. In this case, it doesn't go all the way to the maximum. Right, so since these are just NumPy arrays, there's no reason we can't manipulate them as we do NumPy arrays. So let's just make a red square here in the corner. So I'm going to take a block from row 10 to row 110, column 10 to 110, all three color layers, and I'm going to assign it the value of 255.00. So what color would that be? Well, it's red, green, and blue. So red full, green nothing, blue nothing. So it should be red. And indeed, that's what we see when we execute that operation. It's also possible to have a four-dimensional array. So we now saw that color images, so gray images are just m by n, it's two dimensions. Color is m by n by 3, because you need the red, green, and blue. And then you can also add a fourth layer called an alpha layer, and that determines transparency. So those values will also range from the minimum to the maximum, in this case 0 to 255, and it will determine for how transparent the different parts of the image is. Hey, good morning. Grab a handout. Right, so now we've already seen images with values ranging between 0 and 1 and images with values ranging between 0 and 255. So how does that work? Well, in scikit-image, there's the convention that when an image has, or an array has the data type of float, so if it's a floating point array, the values have to be between 0 and 1. And if it is an unsigned integer 8-bit, it has to run between 0 and 255. And you can also have a 16-bit integers if you want. But the most common formats are the ones that run between 0 and 255 and 0 and 1. So let's generate two of those images just to see that that works. So the first image, I've got linear 0. So I take a linear spacing of numbers between 0 and 1. I generate 2,500 numbers between 0 and 1. And then I just repack them into a 50 by 50 block. Linear 1 gets generated in the same way, except we have values between 0 and 255. Again, we reshape it into a 50 by 50 block. But now this is a 50 by 50 block of floating point numbers. And then I use as type to just make sure that they end up being integer values. Otherwise, NumPy, a scikit-image wouldn't know how to interpret those. I print out a few parameters of those arrays, their data type, their minimum, their maximum, and then I display them both. And here we see that, let's hide the header, hide the toolbar. So here you see that they display identically. Scikit-image thinks that these images are essentially the same. Of course, you've got more precision when you work in floating point, but they're interpreted the same way. Linear 0 is an array of floating point numbers between 0 and 1. Linear 1 is an array of unsigned integers between 0 and 255. And that is the maximum that you can represent with a uint8 array. If you add one value to 255 with an array like that, what would you get? Let's see. So let's say there's an array x. What will happen if I do x plus 1? What will the 255 become? So with uint8, you cannot represent numbers larger than 255, so it jumps around to 0. Similarly, if you've got 0 and you subtract 1, then you get back to 255. So inside of scikit-image, there are a couple of utility functions that can help you to convert between these different formats. You'll see there's a function called image as float and another one called image as ubyte. So if you don't know which format your image is in, you can always guarantee it by simply running image as float on it. And that's typically what a lot of algorithms do, because then you're guaranteed that all the values are between 0 and 1. So here I take the Chelsea image, assign it to the variable image, call image as float on it, call image as ubyte on it, and then I just print the extents of that image. And you see what comes out is that, yes, after I've run image as float on it, you end up with a floating point image between 0 and no larger than 1, and for the uint 81 between 0 and 255 max. And these two values, they represent the same number. It's just that 231 as a fraction of 255 gives you 0.9. Right, so if we've already seen a little bit how to represent or how to display images on the screen with matplotlib. So let's dig into that a little bit deeper. So I'm just going to assign the cameraman image to the variable image. This is just a repeat of the previous import to make sure that you see that you must import matplotlib.pyplot as PLT and NumPy as NP. That's a prerequisite here. And then I'm going to set up the plot. So I'm going to use matplotlib's subplots function. I'm going to tell it that I want two subplots, so two columns, and I want the figure size to be 10 by 5. So matplotlib returns a figure and two axes. The two axes are things that we can plot images on. And then on the first axis, I called it axis jet. I'm going to do an imshow of image with the jet color map. And on axis gray, I'm going to do an imshow with color map gray.
What are the units on fixed size?
I presume that's an, is it inches?
It's inches.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is something you will often come across. You've got a gray level image, you try and plot it, and then you get this bright rainbow colored thing jumping out at you. So that's due to a particularly bad default choice of a color map. In this case, it's called jet. And on this side, on that side over there, you see the same image but displayed in gray. So why do I say this is a particularly bad color map to use to display your data? Well, let's see. I'm going to take the image of the face of the man, and I'm just going to zoom in onto the face area. So I'm just selecting part of that array out. Remember, it's a two-dimensional array, so we can grab a couple of rows and a couple of columns. And then we'll do the same display. So there you go. So you'll notice something here that you don't notice here. Do you see a bunch of contours? Like, there's a fairly strong edge, there's an edge around the eye, it gets pretty blotchy. This is not your imagination. The jet color map is particularly bad in that it highlights this kind of transition. It even introduces false transitions where they shouldn't be. Here's an example that illustrates that even better. So I'm just going to generate a grid of numbers and then calculate the radius from the origin and display that. So there you go. So this is just starting from 0 going up to 1. That's the radius. So it's a cone of sorts, I guess. But you can clearly see this seems smooth. But over here, you see definite rings coming out. So if this is the kind of thing that interests you, you should definitely attend Nathaniel and my talk later in SciPy, where we redesigned the color map, the default color map for matplotlib, and tell you a little bit about how you do that. But in the meantime, just use the gray level color map for displaying images. So if you want to make sure that the default is always gray, then you can execute that line shown. So that sets up Matplotlib to always use gray as the color map. The other property you should probably set is the default interpolation method. So when Matplotlib blows up an image, it uses, I think it's linear, or is it bicubic? But it uses some smoothing interpolation. So if you go to 2x2 image and you blow it up with Matplotlib, it will seem very smooth. And you can avoid that by setting the default interpolation to nearest neighbor. I'll give you a little example of how that looks. But then if you don't want to update your defaults and you want to set it every time, in the imshow call, just always specify color map as gray and interpolation as nearest. It's also fine when you work with color images because then we'll just ignore the color map. Right, so I don't want you to look at this code too much. This is just to set up an interactive demo. You can execute it in your notebook if you want. So let's set this to gray. All right. So this is basically an interactive demo of what I just showed you. You can choose the color map. So where's Jet? So here you see the original image, the face. I just took the top 5x5 block. There's that block. There it's displayed in Jet. And next to it, you see how Matplotlib would display it if you use the default interpolation mode, bicubic interpolation. You can see if I change the interpolation to nearest, I get the pixels like you would expect. Bilinear is a little bit smoother, bicubic even smoother. Right, so image input and output. It's fun to play around with the example images that come with Scikit-Image, but in the end, you'd want to use your own data that you load from disk. The images will typically be PNG, JPEG format, maybe a couple of TIFFs. Since Scikit-Image operates on NumPy arrays, you can use any library that ingests an image and pushes out a NumPy array. But Scikit-Image contains an I/O submodule, and that submodule already wraps much of this for you. So there are several libraries that come with. Pillow is typically installed, or the Python imaging library would typically be available. Matplotlib has to be on your system for Scikit-Image, and many of these libraries can provide that functionality. So we just wrap all of that in the I/O submodule. So you import I/O. And then you load your image by saying io.imread, and you provide a path to the image file. So there we go. I just read the balloon.jpg image. And when you print its type, you see that, yes, indeed, it's a NumPy array. The other piece of functionality you should be aware of is what to do when you want to load multiple images. So often you have a collection of images that you want to load as one. And for that, we've got an object called an image collection. So you use the command io.imreadCollection, and you specify a wildcard, and it will pull in all those PNGs or JPEGs. You can also specify multiple patterns. And then you get this object back called, I called it IC. The type of IC is image collection. And you can see that if you print the image collection itself, it just shows you the list of files that are now contained inside. So the next code snippet, I'm just going to again, create a few axes. How many axes should I create? Well, I want to plot all of these images inside my image collection. So I'm going to create a set of subplots. One row, how many columns? Well, the length of the image collection. And then I'm going to iterate over the image collection and do an imshow on each of the different images. And there you see all the images come out. Right, so any questions so far? Yep.
Is image collection just a list of paths to the images, or is it something more than that?
So image collection behaves like a list, so you can iterate over it, you can query it for its length and so forth. But it does a bit of caching in the background, so it's aware of all these files, and the moment you load the files, they get loaded into memory, or the moment you access the specific image, it gets loaded into memory, and you can set how many images you want in memory at a specific instance of time. Yep. Yep.
Is the order loaded by image name?
It is. Oh, I guess we can just look, yeah. So, yeah, it looks to be alphabetical, yeah.
It's whatever
so, for example, if they were numeric and did not have leading zeros, but they wrote out of order.
Well, let's see. So you want to see whether 00 and 01 would load in order?
Yeah, I can do that.
Okay. Yeah, I think they would be. I think it's sorted beforehand. Yep.
What about frames from a movie?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we've got a section in the documentation talking a little bit about that. What's the library we currently recommend? Okay, Josh will check for us. But there is a package that you just install with pip, I don't know, MoviePy or something like that. And then you just load them in and it provides them as NumPy arrays. And then you could just use all of these tools on the individual frames. Yep.
Can you read
fits? Say again? Fits? Yeah, for sure. So. Scikit-Image has a plugin structure or a plugin infrastructure, and I wonder if we currently do we still ship the FITS plugin?
It relies on AstroPy.
Yeah. What's that?
It relies on AstroPy.
Yeah. So via AstroPy, we load in FITS images. And AstroPy can load them into NumPy array, so then you're again good to go. Any other questions? Any concepts you'd like me to clarify that I touched on so far? All good? Okay, great. So at this stage, I have two exercises, but I'm going to leave this. These are two very simple exercises just to make sure that you can manipulate images. But I think I'd like to go on to the next section just so that we have the foundation in place before these guys start with the bigger examples. So let me... So let's just have a quick look at color and exposure.
To answer the video question, that's an open pull request that will probably be merging in Sprint. It's PyAV, which will be the package for video.
So PyAV is the recommended movie reading module. Right, So like we've seen, images are just numpy arrays, and now we're going to focus a little bit on how do we manipulate those images, how do we adjust their color, etc. So I'm going to load a color image here. Again, it's the image of Chelsea. The first thing I want to do is I just want to grab the red channel out. So remember, the image is, in this case, what's its shape? It's 300 by 451 and then by 3 for the red, green, and blue channels. So let's just go and grab that red channel. And we can do that with this syntax. So color image, take all the rows, take all the color, all the columns, and take band 0. So we've got 0, 1, and 2, red, green, and blue. So let's take 0, and then we display that. But that doesn't look red. So why isn't this image red if I grab the red channel? What's that?
It's one-dimensional.
Yeah, exactly. So I sliced out one dimension of the image. I had red, green, and blue. I just grabbed the red channel. And that red channel image is nothing other than a gray level image itself. So that's what you see displayed over here. If you want to display it as red, you would have to copy it into an m by n by 3 image again, and put that in the red layer, and put nothing in the green and the blue. Yeah. You want to switch to the gray for the default color map. Okay, so you would probably have seen something like this if that wasn't set. Okay, so let's just make that.
Right, there is a global setting file for Matplotlib, but that's outside the scope of this one.
Yeah, so it's good if you saw that. It means you're aware of this thing occurring. So just make sure you set the color map to gray. Right, so the red channel is just another gray level image. And if you take its shape, you will see that it's just 300 by 451. So that does bring us to an interesting point, and that is how do you convert from a color image, so m by n by 3, to a gray level image, m by n? How do you convert from color to gray? What would the first attempt look like? What's that? Average the three values. So just take the average of red, green, and blue. That's a reasonable approach. It gets you pretty close. Why is it not perfect? Well, the eye has different sensitivities for red, green, and blue. So you need to weigh red, green, and blue slightly differently. Actually, it's not too bad if you grab the green channel. Your eye is most sensitive to green. So if you just grab the green channel of an image, you can typically get quite close. But you want to weigh them with slightly different weights. And the skimage.color.rgb-to-gray method will do that conversion for you correctly. It's in the notebook. It's called skimage.color.rgb-to-gray. Right, so maybe let's pause here for a second, and I'll have you guys try something. So what I want you to do is to load in images/balloon.jpg. It might actually be this is probably the right path. Might be .images/balloon.jpg. So load in that image, and then split apart the red, the green, and the blue channels, and display them next to one another, or just display them in consecutive cells if you're not comfortable with doing subplots, just to have a look at what is contained in the red, green, and blue channels. I can mention that just for this tutorial, this is not part of scikit-image, but if you feel uncomfortable using Matplotlib's subplot, we do provide a little module. It's included in the repository called skdemo, and it's got a function called imshowall, and you just provide a list of images or a bunch of images as parameters, and it will display them one next to the other. But that's exactly equivalent to just creating the axes in Matplotlib and then displaying the images one by one. So the solutions are always given right below the exercise, so try and avoid looking at that. Try it yourself and then see how far you get. Right, so let's have a look. Oh, I didn't actually include the solution here, I see. So there's the template solution that doesn't do anything. It just displays the image and then zeros for the red, green, and blue. So let's try and improve that. So we've got color image. So this syntax, by the way, this ellipsis syntax is exactly the same as you could also write color image, rows, columns, zero. So rows, columns, one. Let's see. Yeah, so there you go. So so there you see the red, green, and blue channels, and as you would expect, the red channel is quite bright around areas where you've got a lot of red, and dark in areas where the image is predominantly blue, for example. All right. Let's see. We're going to run out of time, so let me move to histograms. So in the SK demo module, we've got a little utility function called imshowwithhistogram. So it just shows the image as well as the histogram of values. Now, taking the histogram of the image, you have to be a little bit careful. So if you just execute matplotlib's hist command on the image, it's going to complain. So there you see it says that the image must be 1D or 2D, so it doesn't know what to do with a three-dimensional color image. So you have to ravel that image, or you basically have to take all the values and unpack it into a long vector, and then matplotlib would know what to do with the values. Of course, then you're mixing like red, green, and blue values, so it's not ideal. So typically, you would just take a gray-level image and do that, or you would do separate histograms for red, green, and blue. So here's the cameraman image again, and you can see the histogram. So we're just counting for each different gray value the number of times that gray value occurs. And you see something interesting happening here. You see that we've got a lot of values in the darker area of the image, and then you've got a clump of image of values in the lighter part of the image. So that's, in this case, is basically the cameraman himself. He's dark, and then the rest, the background, which gives you the second blob. If we look at the cat image, you can see that I've plotted the red, green, and blue histogram separately here. You can see that they're much smoother. There's no obvious area that stands out, or one clump of values that comes out there. So RGB histograms are kind of cute, but they're not very useful in general. It's kind of hard to interpret, because if you have green mixed with a lot of blue, it's very different from blue mixed with a little bit of red. So much easier to interpret for gray-level images. Right, so just looking at this one again, we can see that this image doesn't use the full extent of our value range very well. So most of our values are clumped up to about 200 intensity. And then between 200 and 255, we've just got a few values in there. And similarly, our lowest peak is around maybe 5 or 10. So there's part of the range that we're not using very well there. So we can tell scikit-image to just rescale the image. So make, in this case, 200 the maximum value, and let's say 10 the minimum value. And all values that were higher than 200 would then simply become pure white, so 255, and all values lower than 10 would become black, zero. So the utility function you use for that is called rescale intensity, and it's inside the exposure module. So we do from scikit-image import exposure, and then we're going to increase the contrast of the image by doing the procedure I described. So we're going to call rescale intensity on our image, and we're going to say pretend that the input range of the image was from 10 to 180. All values above that, above 180, will be white. All values below 10 will become black. So there you see that. Let's show the image above. Right, so you can see a distinct difference between these two images. And their color maps also look somewhat different. I guess I should do. There we go. So the first image was a little bit darker, less contrast. The second image, you can see that the histogram has now been stretched out. Of course, you now have values that saturate into the white, so that's why you have a peak over at 255, and you'll have a little bit of a peak around zero as well. Scikit-Image contains a whole lot of other methods for doing contrast stretching. We've got histogram equalization, contrast limited, adaptive histogram equalization, but we're not going to go into too much detail right now. So I'm going to skip the biggest part of that notebook, but it just details the different histogram equalization methods. In the last few minutes, I did want to talk about thresholding quickly. So in this image, you can see that there should be a cutoff point where we can very easily separate the foreground and the background. Where would you say that would be? Yeah, so in this case, we've actually got quite a wide trough. So we could choose a value anywhere between about 40 and 100. And if we cut off the image there and take only the values below or above that threshold, we should be able to separate the foreground and the background. So let's try that. I've just selected 50. So I set my threshold to 50. And remember that this is just a NumPy array. So I could do, if I do image greater than threshold, then I should get a bunch of true false values. That's also a valid image. So let's display that. And there's what you get. So you see that the cameraman is now all black, so that those are all the values. So those are all the false values, and all the true values are where you're above the threshold. Scikit-Image also contains functions that will automatically try and find that threshold value for you. So one method is called OTSU, the OTSU method. So if you do, if you import the filter module, and you run the OTSU threshold on the image, it guesses that the threshold should have been at 87. It's a guess. It can't do a perfect job. So there's the image thresholded at 87. That looks pretty good too. Right, so I think we should probably take a break right about now. I wanted to do a bit of discussion on color spaces, but I don't think we've got time for that right now. So so can I take 10 minutes of your time to do this example?
Or say, boss.
All right.
So, so we've got a break now from 9 o'clock to 9:10, and then we'll get back here around. We'll start up again at 9:15. Those of you who want to get started with this example, so long. We've got a photo of a green screen. So just two people photographed against a very bright green screen. And what we'd like to do is to help these folks to get into the forest. So there's the image of the forest. And I'd like to transplant them onto the forest. So this is an operation that happens in movies all the time. So I think we're going to use 10 minutes after break just to still work on this. So yeah, feel free to get started on that, so long, and then we'll see you back in 10 minutes. A hint, if you take the color image and you display the red, green, and blue channels, note what you see. So yes, it's a green screen, so of course it's bright in the green channel. There's also something else we see. It's very dark in the red channel. So if you only try and threshold in the green channel, you probably get a fairly good outline, but you might have problems with the jersey here or bright patches on the skin. So maybe you can combine a threshold on the green, on the red, and on the green channels. And for those of you who have forgotten how NumPy is thresholding or Boolean operations work.
Any operation that you can do in terms of NumPy is Boolean operations will give you a mask. And if you use that mask, you can select out the part of the image. Thank you. Right, so there's a rough solution. My first mask I did on the red image, so I picked the areas that were particularly dark, so that includes the background. My second mask I created using the green channel, and I picked areas where the green channel was particularly bright, and then I just combined those two masks. So the combined mask looks something like that. And then I just used that mask to set all areas outside of the people to zero. And then you can take this image and you can add it to the image of the forest. Except if you add it to the forest, you will see trees and bushes and things appearing over the people's faces. So you first have to take the same mask and set the value zero in the forest image, and then you can add the two images together. So, I think I'm going to hand over to Stephen now. He's going to lead you through the segmentation module.
Hi, I'm Steve Sylvester. I work at Continuum. I was here last year. It was my first time here. I went to the Scikit-Image Sprint, and now I'm a Scikit-Image developer. So just a little plug there. So the next segment is about segmentation, that is, yes.
The what? You want the font bigger on the screen, yeah. Like that?
Does it have your custom HTML thing at the bottom?
Oh, yeah, I guess I could, that should fix it.
It should have been on top.
Is that bigger, smaller? You guys can read? Not yet, okay.
All right, segmentation, the process of figuring out what is important in the image and separating what's important from what's not or equally important objects from each other. So here, if you've seen the original Terminator movie, he was doing a scan of his environment and segmenting this man from the background, saying that he was analyzing whether he was a potential threat or not. So we've got some algorithms in Scikit-Image that help you with segmenting an image. And that image could be if you have a petri dish of molecules, you want to segregate the molecules from each other, an object from its background. And there's two ways of doing that. There's if there's good contrast between the images and color space, you can use our contrast separation functionality, or if there's good defined edges, there's edge-based, boundary-based segmentation, generally using the watershed function, which resides in morphology as opposed to segmentation package because it's a bit of a hybrid operation. So we'll first look at SLIC, which is simple linear iterative clustering. And this is a good example of a generic algorithm that existed that we incorporated in a Scikit-Image for use in the package. So a lot of times people come to us and say, hey, I have this paper. I'd like to contribute this algorithm to Scikit-Image. And a lot of our time is spent incorporating those functionalities into Scikit-Image. So here's an example of SLIC, which we're going to use for this the contrast-based segmentation. So you have, as an example, this image has a fairly good contrast between the segments of spices in this bowl. So the algorithm has parameters to it, like most of the algorithms in Scikit-Image. There's the number of segments you think you have in the image and the compactness, which in this case is the relative weighting of the space and color dimensions. So it's a figure of merit for how the algorithm operates. So the higher compactness, the more square the return segments. So each of these, when I get there, I'll show you that you can query docstrings. Let me before I get ahead of myself, execute the intro cells. Okay, so first we'll grab our image and if I look at, nice thing about the notebook is I can hit shift tab and it brings up information about the currently selected function. So within, while you're in the notebook, you can actually query the docstring that way. Or if you wanted to, you could put a question mark after it and then execute the cell. If that were the last thing in the cell, it would give you the help pop up on that as well. So that's how you can figure out what the parameters are for the function and more interactively use these functionality in the notebook. So we're going to head and get a list of labels using the slick function and plot out our initial naive attempt where we've just selected some parameters, and we see it does an all right job of labeling these pieces, but there's still some commingling of the different labels. So we haven't quite hit the right combination of inputs yet. So let's, just the way we're visualizing it, let's look at averaging out the colors of the segments just to get a, so this is taking the original image and sort of fuzzing it up a bit, taking the mean color in its general region as a pre-processing step to get more toward something that's easier to segment.
Okay, can you maybe just print out the labels and show?
Sure.
What the label image are there?
Yes. So you see the label image is actually a list of numbers where each number is a unique label assigned to it, and that's what we plotted on the right-hand side here. Each color is assigned to a different label in the color map. So there's another parameter called enforced connectivity, where we give it a little more intelligence to say we know that these things are bunched together, so try to glob these segments together. So that's what the enforced connectivity parameter will do for us. So we'll see if we get a little bit better answer by doing that. You have a lot less of these small regions now because we've done the pre-processing step to in the original image, and we've enforced small things need to glob together. So think the T-1000 from the second Terminator. So we were a bit overzealous in that some of these spices got merged together. We didn't want them to. So we can start playing with these, the parameters, tweaking it by iteratively and seeing what the effect is. But, so we'll go through a couple more iterations of that, but really what we want to do, and what I'm leading up to, and I wanted to leave time for, was to use the new widget functionality in IPython to real time set these parameters. So you can explore your image by changing the parameters of the algorithm and seeing the effect real time. And that's where the big payoff of the notebook comes in, and that you can drag a slider and it will change the parameters and you can see what effect it has on your image. So you can, instead of running the code over and over again, as you're dragging the slider, the image gets updated and you can find the right set of inputs that will get you to where you want to be. So I'd like to basically take this template and let's try to make a slick function explorer and try to find a good set of inputs for this image. And this may be, probably should have expanded on this. I don't know if that's enough to go on.
I don't know how many people have IPython experiences.
Yeah, that's true. I might have been overzealous in this.
It's fine. Just leave it.
We'll leave it as a great thing to do on your own time.
To aspire to.
Yes. I tend to forget people don't have the same level of experience across the board. But yes, that is the real payoff of the notebook, is the interactivity. And then you can query the doc strings, and it is interactive. It's still IPython. It's interactive Python. So let's go ahead and look at.
Do you want to quickly whip up that thing or?
Live coding.
Yeah.
Oh gosh. All right.
That's the worst that could happen.
I've been challenged. I don't know if I can handle this trackpad.
Should I give you a real mouse?
All right, thank you. All right, so I'm going to take that same block of code, but now it exists within this interact function, so it becomes live. And some initial values, and you can actually specify a range here. I'll just go ahead and let it use all integers. For this?
Yes, basically go, because the only thing that changes is you're basically sticking image in front of the thing.
Right, yeah, that would be an enhancement. This is just for exposing these. If I can line up my, let's see what we get. Nothing like live coding. Okay, I don't know if you saw, there's a little pop-up that said IPython widgets are experimental and will be changing in the future. We have Sylvain over here who's working on that from the IPython team. As soon as that gets stabilized, we have a scikit image viewer that's based on Qt right now. As soon as the widgets are stabilized, plan on migrating that into the notebook, so it'll use IPython widgets, just a plug for that. So as soon as Sylvain finishes, we'll be good to go. Okay, so now let's see this. Get out of here. See if I can affect a good change here.
Is it updating the block?
So it looks like I missed that piece. I'm wondering if this I'm sure all is not doing.
Doesn't your slice need to be the parameters are equal to the input?
Oh, yes. There you go. Thank you. Live coding. Trackpads. I'm sorry, say again?
Does widgets dot interact actually reflect on the arguments that the first argument function receives, or does it just use the keywords you pass
now? Right now I'm using keyword arguments as positional arguments, but yes, it will pass in these keyword arguments to this function.
But I'm just wondering whether it actually does some reflection and looks at what the keyword arguments are functioning.
As far as I know, no. All the smarts are in this interact where I could actually assign a range. I don't remember the syntax off the top of my head to bound end segments between two values, but no, I don't think it's looking at func itself to as far as introspection. It's just passing the data in. All right, let's see if we get something live. There it is. Yes. Success. So as soon as Sylvan's done, you'll be able to have some of this functionality built in as our second image viewer framework. And there'll be plugins where you can interact with the images. If I had time, we could show the QT viewer to look a lot like what's currently there, just in the notebook.
So the sigma parameter here is that how much image is blurred beforehand, before you do the segmentation?
Let's see. And I'm not sure. I think this is kind of I did pick it up. So it's a pre-processing step. We're doing a Gaussian smooth the way we did manually before to the initial images to blur it a little bit to again, better merge these coarse edges in there into a smooth feature. So we're missing a couple parameters that we could have added here, max, iteration, spacing. So those could have all been part of our GUI and they would have showed up as the appropriate widgets. Do you see it created a Boolean for the connectivity because it was a true.
Yeah, just play around with those bits so we can see what happens when you.
Did I miss a variable name?
Yeah, that worked.
Oh, it did?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry? Right. As I said, there's a syntax here. And I think it's just a tuple, but I don't remember off the top of my head to give it a range of allowable values. And then, but a way to give it a default value as well?
I think if you have a keyword in the function, a keyword argument, it will pick up on the default. Yeah, tuple is correct.
Yeah, but so it automatically gave it the middle value, but I think there's also a way to assign it a default value.
Yeah,
ah, I see. Oh, these all have to have values in. Now we're properly using all keyword arguments. Oh, Stefan was right. All right, live coding. Juggle.
So just play around with the segments and the compactors.
So as I select fewer segments, things start coming together. The compactness. Also, you can try to find a sweet spot there. Looks to be about the middle. And change our blur function. So less blur is going to make things start look ragged on the edges.
Why does it make them blur if you give sigma a negative value?
I don't know how we'd handle
that. That's a good question. It should
that probably is a bug. Thank you. Well, it's on the side. It tells you the current value. Yes. What's my end time? 10:15. Okay. So we'll go ahead and look at the other type of segmentation, the watershed algorithm. So this applies to, let's say you have molecules on a red background, all the molecules are equally white. You can't segregate the molecules one from another, but there are boundaries around the molecules. So that's a segmentation there. So the molecules might be up against each other and they're all white, but they have a clear defining border between them. So we'll use our black and white image of coins, and first we'll just explore the Sobel filter is an edge detection, and it's just using a gradient on the image to find hard edges. So see, it did a pretty good job. Let's show just coins what that looks like. So it did a pretty good job of finding the edges of the coins. This is a naive, it's not doing anything special. It's just a gradient filter on the image. So Watershed builds on that to find images, and then you plant a seed in a basin and allow that seed to flood. And where edges meet is where you end up with your segmentations. So it's think of it like you're filling a valley, different valleys. So you say this is the bottom of one valley and another valley, and when they come together, that's where the segmentation is. So we're going to go and look for good seeds. Or actually, we've just predefined them here. Sorry, I forgot this was first. So here you see a linear representation of intensity across a line, and a good seed point would be where the valleys are. And then as you flood, they would come to boundary points. So as you filled up water in here and here, they would meet most likely somewhere in this area. But it's a little easier to see on an image itself. So this is just a how do I get rid of that? That's not worried about it. This is just showing how far from an edge you would have to go to find a non-edge, so kind of an idea of where the boundaries are between valleys and where a good seed point would be. So the furthest you can get from a good edge. So we're going to use that information to pick out seed points, which are annotated in red, as good points for valleys. You see, it didn't do a perfect job, but let's see what we get from applying the watershed algorithm to those seeds on the image. So as a first cut, the image is now labeled with the different label colors. So it actually picked out a good number of individual coins, but there's still some blurring of effects here. We didn't properly segment all the coins yet. So we're going to use the fact that we're going to try to select better seeds. So what we're going to do here is be a little smarter about how we select the seeds, and that knowing that we have circular-shaped objects in this scene. So we're going to reach out to scikit-image-skimage-measure as a region props function, where we can look for regions that have an eccentricity greater than 0.6, being roundish, and use those for our initial coin seed estimates. So now with a little smarter set of seeds, we get a better representation, better segmentation of the image.
But it looks like that's only taking the labels and removing the ones that aren't brown. I don't think that's actually choosing new.
Oh, I'm sorry, yes.
It's one by one, it checks the eccentricity, and if the eccentricity is less than or greater than 0.6, sets that label to zeros in the background.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. Yes. Got lost in the live demo. Catch back up myself. So, yeah, so what we're saying is we know areas that aren't round are background, so we've sought out those areas and we're setting them to the background label, which is zero. So that's all we're doing is making the background more uniform. So we picked out all but this one segment of background area.
If you adjust it to 0.7, does that disappear?
Let's see. See what we get.
There we go.
Yep, fairly good. So there's another instance where you're probably not going to have the first guess is not going to be right, and the ability to play in the notebook, you eventually find the right answer that gives you the best segmentation. I thought there was. So maybe there's a good chance. We don't have a demo for this. Because the demo was supposed to be the
But this may be a good time to try and improve that segmentation by picking better seed points.
Okay.
So those look pretty bad.
So this is using that previous function where we took the maximum point from an edge and used that as a seed point. But it looks like that gave us some false positives in there. So I guess if you have an idea on how to improve that, my live coding is tapped out.
I don't know, does anyone have a good idea of how we can improve those seed points? Let's look at the original image.
And if we had the viewer working, there's actually a watershed demo where you actually physically paint points. So you paint the seed points, hand select them with the mouse, and you can sometimes get a better answer that way. See the original image you want to see?
Threshold that image, maybe.
As a Boolean image?
Yeah, it's just coins greater than, I know what the data type is.
Well, here's a good example of where, if we're not sure of the data type, we can ensure it. Oops. Trackpad. From scikit-image, import image as float. Coins equals image as float. Coins. So now we know this is between 0 and 1. And now we can check out 0.5, a naive answer. So there's a decent separation and contrast between the coins and the background.
Yeah, and then maybe run a closing on that, binary closing.
Is in the morphology
So a binary closing operator is going to fill in these holes for us.
Maybe give it a slightly larger.
So again, I can bring up the. Oh, found the wrong one. Okay. It's not. So we can choose a larger selecting element, the cell M. So an example. No. 2D array of ones and zeros. Thought there was a number of iterations on there. I missed that. Sure, it's in morphology?
I am.
Okay. Radius.
Yes, just the
five. Okay. And this psyllium, the second argument. That did a pretty bang up job. So we could do an erosion to get rid of this kind of feature there.
Or just make the disk slightly smaller, it might work. That's fine.
Okay, so we got rid of one of them. We still got these sort of kissing.
And then you can label the image, and then using region props you can select the centers. Although, I guess that's pretty close to what we want. Yeah.
So, where's that code? NDI.label. Okay, let's give this a segmented. And I lost what was on my clipboard. Come back down. What's a better one than JIT? Cube Helix?
Anything is better than
that. All right. So that did not a bad job.
That's pretty good, yeah.
So, the Watershed's a big hammer. You can sometimes get there by using smaller tools and building up to something.
So you could now go and use the center of each of these and provide that as input to the Watershed, and then you should be able to do better.
So, as Stefan mentioned, my name's Josh. I work for Mayo, go to school there, finished defending my PhD about a little over a year ago. I mostly do medical image processing, but I'm here today to talk to you about panoramas. And I'm not afraid to admit that I love panoramas. Raise your hand if you love panoramas. Okay, great. I have at least half of the audience with me. Panoramas are just amazing because it's so hard to make a good one, but when you see it, it's just, it's fantastic. The layout, just either a tall building or a landscape just sitting there in front of you. So usually you've got to use very advanced tools to do this. Photoshop, some of your phones do it now. That may or may not work quite as well as other methods. But we're going to teach you in this hour how to actually do this using nothing more than scikit image. And we're going to use some advanced topics for this, and I'm going to try and bring everyone along with me, telling you what the code's doing, kind of in a conceptual sense in a couple places, and then if you have questions about the nitty-gritty and how exactly that worked, I'm happy to talk with you offline afterwards or things like that. But we're going to try not to get bogged down in the details too much and worry about how things are done. And of course, the example is fully contained in the notebook here. So first, we'll, as is necessary, make sure we're all on the same page regarding division and the print function. Good point. All right. So I am, if you go into the index, it is either the Stitching Panoramas link here, which is in our index for SciPy 2015, or if you're just using the overall Jupyter in the repository, you can just enter lectures, and the one we are doing currently is Panorama Stitching, the Advanced 3. Thank you for the question. We all on the same page now? Awesome. Okay. So in the scikit image paper that we all wrote, there's a panorama demo that isn't actually as advanced as the one we're going to do today. It needed a separate program. This one actually works even better. So we'll just get a couple of necessary things out of the way to start with. Import NumPy and matplotlib. And all this function is doing is, because we're going to be dealing with more than one image for the majority of this tutorial, it's a convenience function so that we can just toss images at it, and it's going to display all of them. And we don't need to worry about that. So just compare and then throw variables at it. Those will all be images. So we're just going to run that now that I've told you how it works. And you can go back and inspect how that actually does its job later. So Stefan talked about how we load data in scikit-image at the beginning of the four-hour tutorial. And now we're going to use one of those methods. So this is the image collection. So within scikit-image.io for input and output, we're just going to use an image collection. And we already know where they are because the notebook is smart. They're in this directory. And we're going to just load anything that matches that keyword, this wildcard here, JDW_03. And then let's look at them. So I told you about compare. Now let's see how compare works. You'll have to follow along with me. So I'm going to hit Shift-Tab here, which, as Stephen mentioned, introspects the actual function. And so now utility to function display images side by side. So we can put any number of images in here because it's star images. And then we can also hand it labels or other keyword arguments for that get passed to matplotlib. So I'm just going to put in star pano images, and all that does is just unpacks the list, so or unpacks the iterable. So in this case, we have an iterable. Stefan mentioned that you can iterate over this, and by simply doing that, it passes the three different things as separate variables, and now we've got three images. And so these are from the rough trail back to the private arch in Arches National Park last August, and this is private arch right here, but it was too big. It was just too big. You couldn't get back enough, far enough from it with the lens that I had to actually get it all in scene. So I took a couple images instead of just one and hoped that I could handle that later. So when you've got a couple images that you think you could probably put together into a panorama, first things first, you got to handle them. And once you've loaded them, there's a couple steps that you usually think about. You won't necessarily always do each of these, but you'll at least think about them. So first, you might want to resize them down a little bit. Because if you're dealing with something that's 30,000 pixels wide, as the pixel count on cameras continues to increase, that's probably unnecessary unless you're trying to print along the entire back wall of this room. So you could probably save yourself some memory and some processing time by downscaling a little bit. You also may, depending on how you want to actually put them together, want to convert to grayscale. Because some of these things that we're about to do in a few minutes, called extracting features from the images and comparing them across images, some of those are only defined for a grayscale image. Not all, but some are. The one we're going to use here is grayscale only right now. And so we do actually need to convert into grayscale. And then we might want to crop down just a little bit to help things match up. But we're not going to bother with that this time. So we've already talked about RGB to gray earlier in the tutorial. Go ahead and just follow the instructions here. So we want three grayscale versions named Pano 1, panel 2 and panel 0, not necessarily in that order, from our inputs. And let's just do that. So go ahead. I'll give you just about 2 minutes. And I'll need to follow along. And I'll give myself about 1 minute. Okay, so that executes very quickly, and now we can take a look. Again, we just toss the images straight in here. And hey, same thing, just grayscale. So we had to do that in order to use the feature extractor that we want to use for this tutorial. Anybody need more time? All right, moving on. So now, as I mentioned, we need to detect features. So without knowing anything, yes?
Can we just check that everyone's got it loaded in? Because otherwise, I guess they're not going to be able to follow along.
Mm-hmm.
So, does everyone have the 3 images loaded in? If not, I'll come give you a hand.
Yes. Yes. There you go.
Can you make the font a little bit bigger?
I can try.
Perfect, thank you.
Is that now readable to everybody? Great. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and move on, trusting that Stefan and Steven can help bring everyone up to speed. So feature detection. These 3 images, they're not going to overlap directly. We need to figure out how they actually relate to one another. What parts of one image correspond to what the similar parts in another image so that we can actually overlay them. And before we start, we need to actually define one image as a target and one image as a destination. That's because these features are being matched in they have a directionality to the matching. And so in this case, for a 3-part panorama, what we're going to do is we're going to have the center image stationary. And we're going to match both of the other images to it. So the center image is our target for both cases. And that remains stationary while the other ones get moved or warped in whatever way is necessary. So then we're just going to find features in all 3 images. That part right there, that's not directional yet. It's only when you start matching them, taking the features that you found in all these in each image, that the directionality matters. Okay. So what we're going to use here is what's called oriented fast and brief features, which is available as in skimage.feature. As orb, as the abbreviation. So what this cell does is first brings our features on board with the import statement, and then initializes them. So this is one of the areas in the package where we do have a class-based interface, a little bit more like scikit-learn than the functional interface that we've been talking about in the previous tutorials. So in this case, we need to initialize and set up orb. And the way we do that is we set orb equal to some value, sorry, some variable, and then we tell it a couple things about the actual feature detection that we want to run. So in this case, we're going to find 800 different key points within each image, and this is just one of the keywords in orb. There's many more, but for the and feel free to experiment on your own using this as a basis. But for the purposes of this demo, we're just going to use this example. Okay, so detect key points. These 3 lines detect the key points just in the panel 0, which on my screen is the leftmost image. And so first we're going to detect and extract. That's a method available within the orb class that we defined earlier. And then once this is done, this is what actually takes time to run. That's essentially all of the runtime right there. And then after it's detected and extracted them, those key points are stored as the attributes, key points, and descriptors. So essentially all we do is we use this to detect and extract the key points within the image we pass it, and then we're just reading back out what it found and setting those equal to values that then we can go use later. The only reason we're reading them back out is so that we can then reuse it. And yes? What kind of algo?
Yeah.
So this is the oriented fast and rotated brief features. And if you just Google that phrase, you can find the original paper, and it's referenced in the doc string, I believe, as well. Okay. Yes. No. Yeah, we go through a painstaking process to make sure that things are, in fact, appropriately licensed before they get included in the package. So that was one. What I gave you was one, but we need to detect the key points in the other two images as well. And so go ahead and just start modifying this, essentially. Work with me here. We need to give it the next image. And this same detector can run multiple times, and it simply overwrites the key points and descriptors. So if we hadn't set them equal up here, we would have lost them at this point. So we're going to go ahead and remember those and associate them with what we're considering image one now. And then we'll do that again, similarly for image two. Now on this 5-year-old MacBook, this is going to take about 8 seconds to run, but some of you have better hardware out there and it may be a little bit faster. But it doesn't take that much time to actually extract these features. And this is going to be our longest step in the entire tutorial in terms of computation. So we're working on a couple of different approaches to parallelism. One of the barriers has been that Clang under Mac OS X hasn't supported the OpenMP protocol, so we have a lot of Cython in the package, and we would really love to just, and we've recently, in a set of pull requests, essentially released the GIL everywhere possible, but we haven't moved to P ranges everywhere because Clang doesn't, or hasn't support OpenMP. We're watching that closely, and the Continuum IO guys are developing something interesting called Dask, which allows you to kind of get out of core with a different approach, and we're looking into that as well. Right now, this is not going to run parallel. So I'll go ahead and run this, and it'll take a few seconds. And it's done. So that wasn't directional. We just took each image and detected features in it. You could do that with any image. You could do that with three completely unrelated images, and it would be perfectly happy to do that. But once you get to this point where you're trying to match things between images, is where the directionality and the relationship between them starts to matter. And so in this case, and I apologize because to make the font readable, I've had to cut off a little bit. I tried to hold myself to the standard PEP 80 characters, but we'll see if I can help myself a little bit here and get things back on the screen. So we can all read along. So the idea here is to match things in the correct order. So in this case, we're taking... So actually the way I coded this up is that I did not do them in the correct order. And then I fixed it later. So you can see that if I had taken care of the directionality at this stage, descriptors 1 would have been the second argument in both of these, or the first argument in both of these. And then that would have continued on further. The point is you have to pay attention to this. So you can reverse, you'll see me reverse index things in another couple of cells, and that's to account for what I just mentioned. So this matching step doesn't take very long once we already have the features extracted. Now, there's a convenience function that we also have in the feature package, or sub-package, I should say, called plot matches. And so that's when you go to actually look at these features between more than one image. It's able to actually, within it's using matplotlib, plot the little features as circles and then draw lines between all the matches that they found. And so you get just this mass of lines drawn on top of the image. And so we're going to import plot matches here and then just pass it the axis that we defined with the plot subplots command. And this is probably going to be too big now that I've zoomed my screen up, so let's make it slightly smaller. And essentially all these arguments are is it needs to know where to actually do the plotting, so we give it an axis to plot on. We give it the two original images, which it's going to put right side by side, and then the key points on the images. So that point, it's drawn all the circles. Then the matches lets it actually connect the circles. That's all that's going on. So when I execute this cell, it actually takes matplotlib a little bit to actually run. And looks like I chose well. 8 is a good width for this. And you can see all these little black circles is where it found points. And not all of them match. So like this one over here, it doesn't match. And it shouldn't, because that particular area isn't on this image at all, because I had panned right at that point. But you know, it's not perfect. There's some things down here that shouldn't be in frame at all that are getting matched up here in the clouds. And while there's a decent signal going on, you can tell that most of the things are actually matched pretty well. There are inaccuracies here. And so we've got to deal with that, or else they're going to be a problem for our calculated fit. So, but before we do, let's actually just look at the other set of matches for the other two images. And it's in a similar place. Actually, this one looks a little bit better, but there's still things that shouldn't be there. Okay, so how do we deal with that? Well, instead of trying to calculate the one perfect transform that actually does relate these images together, we're dealing with the real world at this point. So we've got features that we've calculated, and we're trying to relate one image to another using a limited number of features and an imperfect amount of data. So we have shipped what's called RANSAC, or random sample consensus, and that's a really handy way to try and figure out inliers, or the best possible subset of a random set that most closely corresponds to each other. So that's what RANSAC does. It's also available in scikit-learn. And this is particularly helpful to us in this context, because with RANSAC, we're going to actually take these matches, including the bad ones, which you can see visually, but teaching a computer how to recognize that visually would be a tough task. And instead, we're just going to try and figure out, well, which of these match? Where's our highest signal? And if you want to read more about RANSAC, I encourage you to do so, because it's a very powerful technique and not used as much as it probably could be in academics and industry yet. I do apologize that this is off screen, but we can help ourselves a little bit. And there's a lot of different options for RANSAC. And before we've gotten into this at all, I've sort of picked a set that's going to work well as a starting point. Again, you can experiment with these with any set that you want to do. But it's a fairly powerful technique, and it isn't necessarily overly sensitive to the actual to small variations in the parameters that you're telling it.
Josh,
yes?
I was away for a second. Did you explain how RANSAC works?
I mentioned that it, okay, that's written out here. I'll go ahead and read it. The idea is that it picks random subsets. And so you have a whole set of matches or data. And it picks a random subset of that data and repeatedly does that, just continually picks different random subsets. And based on what is in and out of the random subsets that it chooses, it is able to figure out that that one's creating more of a problem than others. And maybe I'll shift that over to the side. And it is iterative. And so the longer you let it run and the more time you give it, the closer it will approach a true value. In our case, I've actually set it to a fairly low value deliberately so that we all get slightly different results that aren't perfect, that would give us a little more of a challenge later on down the line. But it'll also be quite fast.
So can I give an
example? Yes, feel free.
So say you've got a point cloud of data, two-dimensional point cloud and you want to fit a straight line through it. So one way to do that would be to do a least squares fit to your data. But if you have outliers, then the outliers can skew that fit quite badly. So you've got a point cloud and maybe a couple of outliers. But if you fit your line to all of that data, the line runs, you know.
So the line will run through the cloud, but also through the outliers. And RANSAC is aimed at rejecting those outliers and doing a good model fit that doesn't take the outliers into account. So in the case of the line, what you would do is you would pick the minimum number of points. So how many points would you need to fit the line? Two, right. So you would pick two data values at random, and you'd fit the line through it. And then you'd say, how many of my data points actually lie close to this line? And you just count. So maybe you've got 100. Pick another two. Fit the line again. How many data points fall close to that line? Maybe only 80. You keep repeating that procedure, and at the end of the day, you take the model that fits the most data points. You say that's the right model, and we do the same thing with the matches, but now it's a slightly different model that you're fitting.
Thanks, Stefan. Okay, great question. So the question was, what is the model in this case? And the answer is that it's a projective transform. And we've imported that here. And so first we import the actual transform model. And we have several different transforms available in the transform subpackage. And the idea with those transforms is that they can be either used or passed as the model to RANSAC. And so we're just giving it the model here at this point in the code. So RANSAC, we're giving it the data, source and destination points, and then our projective transform. That's what's going on. So at that point, it knows what model it's fitting with the data we gave it. And the rest is smaller parameters that define how it fits. Answer your question? Great. OK. So in this case, you can see that I've had to index these 0 and 1, and then 1 and 0 here. And that's because I didn't fix the directionality previously. So I'm fixing that here now. And the reason that the order is reversed has to do with the fact that these transforms expect the origin in a slightly different place. This handout that I've given you notes that rows and columns are how we talk in scikit-image, and that is true. But specifically for the purposes of warping, because all of the literature essentially assumes x standard xy with the origin in the lower left instead of the upper left, we have to reverse the x-axis in order for it to warp properly. And so I'm reversing the rows in this instance, I believe. Okay, so when I run this, it's going to get the robust model for both of them, and it ran almost instantaneously, even on old hardware. So after you run RANSAC, it's important that you check out your results. You're not going to know otherwise. So basically, we're just going to go up and copy our plot matches from previous. And what RANSAC has given us is an index that tells us where the points are. Tells us where the inliers are that count. Those are the ones we're going to actually use. And a model, then that's the actual transform that we're going to use with warp later. So the model is a projective transform. The inliers is kind of like a mask that we can actually index directly with, as I instruct you here. So we're going to use essentially the exact same code, but we're going to select just the matches that we decided were good. And now, those points that were kind of incorrect and going all over the place, they're gone. So all I did was add the indexing to the matches. So I picked the inliers, which are from RANSAC up here. And I said, OK, so I know where these are all the matches. I just want the matches that we decided were good matches. Make sense? And we're just going to do that again, but for the other one for completeness. So in this case, I'm just going to go back up and copy this version to make sure I get everything correct. I do apologize that things are running off the right-hand side here. Okay. And that's all I did. I just added inliers 1, 2. And so now we're only going to look at the matches that are known good. All of the key points are still plotted, but the matches are limited to just the known good ones. And great. That one also looks like we've rejected essentially all of the bad matches. Now your set of good matches is probably not the same as mine, because RANSAC starts with R, and that stands for random. And so everyone has a slightly different result from that. And that'll play into the fixing it later. Okay. So now that we know how to warp these images, we need to actually put them in place. And so our transforms that we've calculated, we need to actually apply them. So each image needs to be moved a little bit. But the first thing we need to do is figure out how big this transform is going to be. And it's not going to be the same for all of us, because depending on how your image is warped, that corner may be a few pixels different. And so the whole necessary canvas that we need to paint on is going to be individual. And so to fix that out, we've got a fairly lengthy cell here that all it does is apply each of these transforms individually to a set of points that essentially is 0, 0. It's the corners. It transforms the corners alone through the transform that we just figured out individually. And that's what these two lines do here. So we define the corners, and then we warp them into place using the two transforms. And then we play a fun game where we combine all three and look and see what are the lowest ones, what are the highest ones. Because at this point, we haven't moved anything, and so they'll be either beyond or negative, are the ones we're trying to find. And then by taking the maximums and subtracting to assumedly negative or at least zero minimums, we get the whole size of the canvas. And then we're just a little bit careful here with trying to make sure that the resulting shape is correct and an integer type. So I walked you through that, not necessarily realizing that I've probably lost a few people, but it's going to be on YouTube. And this is essentially general. So you can take this workflow, copy-paste it, use it elsewhere, and with minor tweaks, be able to figure out your canvas size. Whether you're using two images, four images, you'll be fine. It doesn't take long to run that one. It just seems like there's a lot of stuff to cover. So now that we know how big our image has to be, we need to actually take our individual inputs, the grayscale images that we've got, and we need to move them into place. So the first one does actually need to move. We said we were going to keep that one stationary, and I lied to you just a little bit. And the reason I lied is that it is kind of stationary, if you think about it as expanding the canvas around it, except that's not how it worked. It thinks it's in the upper left corner. And so we need to move it into the middle. And the first thing that we do is just take the minimum corner values, which are the negative ones, and apply that as just a similarity transform, which is a less general transform than the projective. So essentially, in this line, all we do is we move the middle actually into the middle. The other two are more interesting. It's important to note that warp takes the inverse transform. Again, this is a convention thing, and you can always obtain it using the dot inverse. So I'm not going to get bogged down in what all of these keyword arguments are. I'm just going to show you the results. But it is important to note that what we, sorry, there is one I'm going to focus on. See this CVAL? So I'd say we're going to have part of our canvas, which will be each image, but none of these images will cover the whole canvas. So what happens to the other values? That's what this is for. So this tells us how we fill the values that don't actually correspond to any of our inputs. And so in this case, we're going to set them all equal to minus 1. And the reason we choose that is because it's out of the range of the original image so that we can find it and identify it and store that for later. So we're masking that specifically so that we can use it in the future, and we'll know why when we get there. And then we set it back to 0 so we're not breaking the rules of the data type. Once you've transformed something, it's going to be floating point because these pixels, they correspond not identically to the pixels in the other image, and so it will usually interpolate slightly in order to actually get you the best result possible, and then you can you can control that with the order keyword argument here. So in this case, we're using a cubic interpolation method. 1 would be nearest neighbor, 2 would be bicubic, this is cubic. And this runs very quickly. So in this step, we've moved the first one into place, and we've applied it, and we know now where it isn't. Okay, and now we're just going to do the exact same thing with warping panos 0 to 1 and 2 to 1. The only difference between these calls is that we're now, instead of using a simple translation transform, we go ahead and use that model that came right out of RANSAC. So we use that model, but guess what? We also need to add an offset to that model because for the same reasons that the other one needed to be moved into the center, that one also thinks it's in the upper left still. So these models can be combined using simple addition, and then we grab the inverse of the model. And at that point, we can apply this transform where we had the previous one. Again, looks kind of complicated, but it's essentially the exact same thing that we did previously. And if you screw this up, you just look at the result that comes out and you see that it's, you know, it's way over where it shouldn't be, and you know that you need to kind of go back and look at things again. So you can be iterative with this. And I'll just go ahead and run that one. And then the right panel is the exact same thing as the left, except now it's the 1-2 model from RANSAC instead of the 0-1. Okay. So we've talked a lot. Let's actually look at the results. And voila. This looks pretty good. So this one's moved not exactly into the center. And the reason it isn't is because this one, it turns out, got extended further to our right than this one got extended to the left. And the resulting necessary size here that we calculated is exactly large enough to fit every pixel from the transforms. So now that we have these three, we're about ready to kind of put them together. So let's just do it. Let's do it. Let's just average them together, all right? So I'm going to give you a couple minutes to follow directions here. So all our goal is to take these warped images, which are these ones that had the underscore warped, and do what these say. So we're going to try and average them. So we're going to sum them up. We're also going to add the masks together. That's one of the reasons why we were trying to track the masks earlier, so we know what to divide by when we're actually dividing, because there will be a section where all three of them are overlapped in the middle. There we need to divide by 3. Around that, there will be a section where there's 2 overlapped. That we need to divide by 2, but on the edges, there's only 1 image there, and we don't want to divide by 0 errors either. So that we only need to divide by 1, and so that's why we're tracking the masks. So go ahead. I'm going to give everyone, let's say about 4 minutes, and I'll start in just a couple. All right, I'm going to start, and we'll revisit this a little bit throughout, so don't worry if you're not quite done. There's the sum. Let's make sure I know what I'm talking about.
talking about here. Yep. It's pretty simple. Did anyone get divide by zero errors after this step? Yeah, a couple. I'm going to show you a fun feature of NumPy that you may not be familiar with. So we need our minimum of this array to be 1, or else we're going to get those. Because these overlaps, there's black areas on the top and bottom where no image was, and so we're going to have divide by zero errors. Unless we actually find the maximum of these two arrays, and NumPy will happily broadcast one up to the size of the other argument. And so in this case, it's going to say, oh, okay, so everything in this array is going to be at least 1.
What is fmax?
Fmax is, it's a float maximum, I believe.
Would max also work?
I tried max. I don't think it actually broadcasts like this. Yeah. Okay, so we're probably good, right? Right? Oh, that doesn't look right. So what happened? Anyone have any ideas?
Just layered them.
But we supposedly fixed that because we were tracking the max masks and we were adding that together, and I was saying that we're going to divide by 3 in this middle area and 2 here, and so why didn't that happen? Well, okay, let's just look at what the overlap is. What's overlap look like? It looks okay. So that didn't work. That's a problem. So this is just a mask of zeros and ones. And this goes back to what Stefan was talking about at the beginning of our lecture, because guess what? Each one of these masks is a Boolean if you look at the D-type. And what happens when you add, when you have it a Boolean to a Boolean? 1 plus 1 is 1. It won't actually fix the type for you. But you can use Python's smart typing if you just multiply one of these at the beginning by an actual integer, and then it says, oh, okay, so it's actually an integer now. And you will get something that resembles what we actually wanted.
It's kind of evil.
It is. It really is. Sometimes it feels like it's working against you a little bit, but it's not. Yes. So you could have beforehand cast all these to int, or I could take this first one and call, say, as type, and that would work too. And you get the same thing. The key is that you essentially get them cast to int early on so that it takes that and passes it through. If you just cast to int on the second one, order of arguments would have combined them, and I think that would actually be fine. But if you cast to int on the third one, then it would combine the first two, and they would still be bool, and you would only have a maximum of 2. So I went through that specifically to tell you to be careful with your types. But now that we actually have that, we'll apply the normalization again with the corrected version, and now we'll actually see something that's more like what we want, right? Well, almost. There's still problems here. So can anyone, and I'm not sure how well it's displaying, tell me a couple things that aren't perfect about this image? Yeah. The black lines aren't ideal. I'll give you that one. Anything else that's a little more subtle? The middle's blurry. Yeah, it is. And if you look at the original images at higher resolution than I probably can display on the screen, but you can do that, it was tack sharp all the way through that region. So why are our middles blurry now? Anyone have thoughts? Correct. So we don't have an exact correspondence between these arrays, and so the more that we ask to combine together, the worse it gets in terms of the actual the result that you get at the end. So we got two problems, and neither of them are really acceptable. And that's why I titled this section, Combining Images the Easy and Bad Way.
The black lines, just for completeness, they're there because of the way that the edges are handled by the warping. So when you have an edge in a warp, let's just say it comes in like this, and our pixels are, of course, jagged. So some of these values, the original pixels, don't correspond to a full pixel in the output, but they correspond to a partial pixel, and we told it to fill all the other area with -1. And so in that area, it says, oh, okay, so you got about half and half there, and it combines them. Well, when it does that, obviously it pulls the whole image down, and you get these black lines. If you set C-val to 1 or 2, they'd be light lines. But there's no way that you can get rid of them entirely. If you set it to 0.5, they would be kind of a grayish value that wouldn't be quite as noticeable necessarily, but they'd still be there. So how do we fix this? Well, let's step back, and as we've established, maybe it's not the greatest idea to actually try and blend these pixels one to one. So instead, let's look at how this actually appears. So all I've done here is I've taken panel 1 and subtracted from it panel 2. And our result and plotted the result. So because now we've got negative and positive values, this flat gray area, this is all 0. And in here, our difference, you can see it's near 0 for a lot of it, but not all of it. And so when you get to the edges and it starts looking like an embossed appearance, that is where they are inaccurate. That's where our transform didn't match our images. And it turns out that even if you had the one true transform that related these two images, in most cases, you would still have this problem, that if you're dealing with real images from real cameras, because your optics aren't perfect. And so the corners won't be a true flat field unless you're dealing with very advanced scientific equipment. So usually you're going to have problems off-center, and they get worse the farther away they get. So my point is that essentially blending things together using that average technique that we just did is almost never going to be your best approach. So you would have no structure here, none whatsoever. It would be flat gray if they were perfectly overlapped. And so let's conceptually think about how to combine these without any overlap, but just essentially like a puzzle, where you have one and the other just perfectly matches it. You could think, if you paid someone that, you know, has great Photoshop skills, they could probably, you know, define a great path through here that would be pretty darn close to zero. You could probably sketch something out, sort of like I just have done with the mouse, and say, eh, that's probably a good match. And I bet it would work if you actually did that. But we can be greedier. We can be better than that. We can find the best possible match for all of our individual transforms. And the way we do that is using graph theory. Now, when people say graph theory, a whole lot of folks just sort of they get worried. You know, it's like, oh, that's a graduate level technique. You know, it's something very complicated. I'm going to try and explain graph theory to you in less than 5 minutes, probably less than 3 minutes. At least one part of graph theory. So, what we want is essentially a path that's going to take us from top to bottom. In this case, be from left to right if you're doing a vertical panorama. That is going to start at one place, maybe the top, and start and end at another place, say the bottom. And we want it to find the minimum, the cheapest path that it can take to get there. And the cost, the toll that it has to pay as it's trying to get from point A to point B, is the sum of all the values it has to go through. That is called a minimum cost path. And we have that available in scikit-image.graph. I think I did that in under 2 minutes. So all you need to do this is know where you want to start, know where you want to end, and give it this cost array. That's where the subtlety is, the cost array. So much of what I'm going to talk about in the next few minutes is how to actually define the cost array to give it as much freedom where we want it to be able to have freedom, and to constrain it where we don't want it to have freedom. So first, we're going to just define a few seed points. And I arbitrarily chose to just start it a third for 0 to 1. I'm starting it a third of the way along the top and a third of the way along the bottom, and then 2/3. Turns out this is you could start it as half -1 and half +1. It's that powerful. It'll get you the same. So feel free to play with these and see that you're essentially getting the exact same results back. Now we're going to construct a cost array. This, what comes next is a complicated function that I'm not going to go through in detail here in the tutorial, but I have commented and documented so that you can go through it and examine it on your own time, and feel free to, you know, pin me down afterward and ask more pointed questions if you like. But I'm going to show you what it does instead of showing you how it does it. So all it needs is to start with the difference image, but we're going to start with an absolute value of the difference image. Now, why do we want an absolute value instead of just tossing the difference image in? Yeah, it's a sum. It's a naive sum. And so the total cost is what it's trying to minimize. And so if you give it an area that has negative values, it's going to say, fantastic. I'm going to give you the worst path possible that goes through all these negative values and into the positive ones. So in this case, we need to constrain it, and we're going to make sure that we make everything positive. So it all is expensive if it's not zero. And then the function also requires the mask of the area around the difference, just the difference, because that's what we really want it to go through. We don't care about where just one image is or just the other image is. It's that overlap that we care about. Then, because we also, so we're constraining it a little bit, and then we're relaxing, and then we're constraining, and now we're going to relax again. So we're going to set the top and bottom, remember, row column indexing, so this is row zero and row last. We're going to set both rows equal to zero. So we're essentially, that's why it doesn't matter where we start, because it's free for that thing to slide all along the top and all along the bottom to pick the best path vertically. If you were doing a vertical panorama, you would essentially just transpose these and set the left and right sides to be zero. Okay, so let's look at it. So that function that I wrote, that's big and complicated, essentially all it did was it filled the image with ones, which are expensive because these are close to zero now. And other than that, all it did was make this little shading right here. Complex for that little, you know, just a little bit of shading. But the reason that's needed is because let's say the perfect path starts there. That path would be disincentivized because it's farther away from the edge. So if we just left this as pure ones, it would have to go through more of them before it actually gets into this region than over here where it's near. And so all that function does is say, okay, let's look at how far away our difference region is from the edge, all the way along here, and let's discount the paths that are just a little further out, so that the sum of this vertical line is the exact same as the sum over here where it's closest. That's all ones. That's all the function did. So conceptually, that probably made more sense than trying to go through everything that I did in that function. But feel free to look at it and see how I did it in your free time. There's also an area in that function where you have to separate out this type of an area so you don't make that as cheap as this, which would then, that would be cheating. So now that we have our cost array and we know where we're going to start and stop, although it doesn't hardly matter, we're going to actually go find our minimum cost path. So from the graph subpackage, we're going to look for the route through the array. We're going to find the best route through this array. So first we give it the cost function. I'll just drop these down so we can all see them. And then these points, which is just the start and end point that we've defined earlier. And then we tell it that it's fine to go on the diagonals. We'll let it do that. That's all that says. If you set this to false, it could only go up, down, left, right. But we'll be okay. It's fine. It can use diagonals. Then the results, the second thing that it would happily give us is the cost to get to any point. But we don't need that for the purposes of this example, so we'll just null that. And go ahead and make this an array, because it gives us a list of lists. So we run that. And it, let's see, what didn't I run? Down. What's that?
Down
down. No, I'm looking for mass points. I feel like it was in that. Yeah, that's where it is. Just talk straight through a cell. I've run this up and down. I wasn't expecting any errors, but you know, that just kind of happens. Very fast. You would expect this that it would be kind of complicated to ask for this, because it's finding the path to every point in the image. And yet that took almost no time. And it's because it's a little bit easier constrained, because it can only go from one to the next. Much easier than the traveling salesman, for example. So let's look at it and see how that worked. In this case, all we're going to do is just plot the difference image that we've seen previously, and then we're just going to take the paths in this point, the points in this path, and plot them. And so we'll get a blue line overlay. And so this right here for me, this is my best path. Every one of you is going to have a different one. Because, again, your overlap is slightly different. But you have found, and you can be confident in that, you have found the best path for your set of images. Okay, so now that looks fantastic. And I've talked about the irregularities. So now we just need to turn that path, because all we have is the actual path right now, into a mask where we know where that left image should be. And so we start with zeros. So zeros like this other image over here. And we'll just give it an integer data type. And we will set all of these points. We just throw those points in as one. And just take a look at that. And we've got just a nice white path that goes through. But we need to fill this whole side here. We essentially need the Photoshop bucket tool. And we had a little discussion before this tutorial whether I should include that bucket tool or use it through a different function that's already included in the package that has the exact same code in it but works slightly differently, and we went for that latter one. So what label does is it starts in the upper left corner here, and it says, oh, I'm going to take everything connected to this and label it zero. Start with zero, and then the next thing that I find, I'm going to label it one and continue. So in this case, all I want is zero. So I've run labeling. I've given it my mask, which is this sucker. And my connectivity is one, so it can only go in certain up, down, left, right directions. And set that back equal to one. So you run this, and now we've done that fill. We've used the bucket tool. So this mask is now the portion of our final image that corresponds to pano 0. So now we just move on. We do the exact same things for images 1 and 2. I'm not going to show you quite as many intermediate figures this time. This is the exact same call to costs, with the starting with the difference image and then giving it the mask that corresponds to just the overlapping region. Set the top and bottom to zero, all right? Oh, but we're going to do one more thing. Some of you will have a path that infringes pretty strongly into the middle. And when you have that happen, we really don't want to have these paths conflicting with each other. So what we're going to do is we're going to say anywhere mask zero is positive, we're going to penalize that. We're going to say, don't go there. And so then, once we add that additional constraint, we get something that looks almost exactly the same, except it's got a bite out of it. And in this case, mine hugged the left pretty well, but some of you probably have a bite into the middle here. And so then, because we've penalized that area, it's not going to go there. Again, you got to be, they're like little kids, these paths. You got to lead them along and make sure that they do exactly what you want them to do. And your results may look slightly different. So we use the exact same set of arguments to find our find our minimal cost path again through here. And you'll note that I've overridden the previous points because we've already used that. We've tossed it into an array. We've generated our mask. We've saved that, so we don't need that variable to stay anymore. Again, almost instantaneous, super fast. And how does it look? Looks pretty good. And this is a, I couldn't have planned this better. You see how the embossing is on these two sides is stronger, but the, in the middle there, it gets less and less, and we've just, we've bullseyed it right down the, what is visually, clearly, the correct region. But if you tried to just scribble that with your hand, you wouldn't be perfect. This is the best path, again, for my image, and yours is the best for yours. Okay, so like before, we just need to actually define this mask. We'll put it in a different array. We're going to go ahead and use the label tool again this time, so it starts on the left with zero. Sorry. Starts on your left with zero, comes across, meets that path, says, oh, that's maybe going to be one. And then the other side, because that's what we want this time, that's two. So we're going to take the label that's equal to two, make that our one in our mask, and voila. We've done it. So now we know where one is, we know where the other is, and we're going to be a little bit lazy for the final mask and say that's where neither of these are. So we're going to take both of these together using OR and then say where that isn't. And that'll be where the middle image gets tossed in. Okay. The only purpose for this function is to add an alpha channel that includes masks to the image. You can skip it for now. But essentially, where previously we had RGB in the third channel, so we have rows, columns, RGB. Now we've got RGBA. So it adds a fourth dimension there.
It's a transparency that you added.
Yes, this is a transparency. And so we just define that. We then use it. And so in this image, I want a mask that corresponds to this. And again, we're masking to select the area that we want. So we're all we're really saying is that that area that we found and we made the mask for that defines panel zero, now we're just we're applying that. And when we send these things then to matplotlib, matplotlib understands alpha blended images. And so outside the alpha regions, it's white. It's transparent. It's not there. So now we have an awesome jigsaw puzzle. And all that's left, really, is putting them together. So we're going to start with our standard subplots command here. And I'm going to turn off the interpolation so it's as sharp as possible, as Stefan mentioned. And I'm using imshow rather than, and I don't need to add the gray because I've already, in this thing, I've handled that problem. So how did it work? That's better. Agreed? Everybody get something that's just a little bit better than before? Just a little bit. All right. Sharp through the middle, no gray lines. This is how you want to make a panorama. But we're not done yet. So we've done all this, and we've done all this with smaller images, which are easier to process. But nobody really wants to look at a black and white panorama unless, you know, you're being deliberately artistic in that way, shape, or form. Let's get the color back in. And so we don't have to go and retrace all of our steps. All we have to go is remember what that model was and then reapply it to our color images because Warp is smart enough to understand color as well. And so it'll bring all of the RGBs right through that transform for us. And so these, they may look complicated, but it's the exact same Warp command that we had previously. The only difference is that we're taking pano images, which is our image collection from forever ago when we loaded this, that's still in color instead of the gray transformed ones. So we go ahead and execute this. It doesn't take all that long. And of course, we have to mask them with the masks that, again, we already know. So we go ahead and apply them again. And now we can look at our final results in color. In full color, folks, there we go. And if you would like a souvenir, you're welcome to save it. Now you'd think I'd be done. But oh no, we can keep going. Once more. Because I know someone out there is just burning to ask, well, those were pretty well overlapped panoramas. Did you cherry pick this to be like, you know, an image that's pretty easy for the tutorial or what have you? And the answer is, well, yeah, a little bit. But I also provided another set from a different part of Arches National Park. That's a more difficult one to actually work with. So scroll back to the top, and all you have to change is when we actually did this image collection here, use a different wildcard. So instead of 03, use 9. And that will go and get these images, which I do apologize for how pixelated they are on my screen, but they're going to look better on yours. And so this is the trail to Delicate Arch in Arches. Not actually Delicate Arch, sorry, but the trail to it. And all I'm going to do is just ask nicely to run all of the cells below. And we will sort of talk, we will just observe the results. So okay, so they're gray. That makes sense. We wanted that. That still works. We've extracted the features from all three. We've matched them. Now we're going to look at key points. Ooh, now we got some poorer matching going on here. This might be more of a challenge. And then this one also looks like it's maybe not as well matched as the previous one, but it didn't have as much overlap either, so that's kind of expected. Then we go through and we use Ransac again, all exactly the same, argument-wise. And so now let's see how things work. Hey, better. Ransac's still working. And I don't know why I just zoomed in extra there. Oh, it ran the last cell. Okay. Sorry, folks.
Can you clear the output?
I can just clear this cell's output, right?
Yeah.
That should revert it. Okay. Sorry for the funhouse ride there with the scrolling. Okay. So now we've got our matches, which are going to be different. Again, yours won't quite be the same as mine, but they should be consistent. And then again, we've got a set of matches here. Rejected the false matches. I don't see any that are obviously incorrect left. We'll go ahead and warp these images. This thing, chunk here, to figure out how big the final image is, that still works. And then we warp the images into place, and we look at them, and that looks reasonable. And we'll go ahead and just ram home the fact that this is not a great way to combine images. In fact, it's even worse this time. And the reason it's worse is because now we're using the corners of the images. And so it turns out that my lens, I had it open about all the way. I had it as wide as it would get. And so it's got vignetting. It's a little darker in the corners than it is in the middle. It's not consistent as far as the exposure goes. And if you just look at one image, your eye corrects for that and you never see it. But if you try and actually overlap more images and you're using that that corner region, problems. So that's why you get sort of a darker look in the sky there. And of course it's blurred out in the grass because the grass was blowing. Okay, so look at the difference image. There's a lot of stuff going on in the grass, not unexpected. And then we'll go through and look at our results from the minimum cost path. In this case, the correction needed is more subtle, but it's there. And found my path. Yours will look different. Go ahead and make that mask. Apologies if I'm going too fast. Look at the difference image on the second one. A little more of a significant correction here. It's necessary. And then find the best path there. Note that it's not going for the corner this time, and that's because of the vignetting. If it went for the corner, there would be an intensity gap or a jump right there. And so these paths, they're very smart so long as you teach them exactly what you want them to do. And so our final mask, when we put these together, looks like this. And I encourage you to try and find the seams. And then, of course, we can combine them in color. And there you have it. If you want to look at the full color image this time, it overwrote the previous one right there in this directory in the lectures. So I apologize if I haven't been as Socratic as I could have been through that last run through. I'm trying to stay on time. Does anyone have any burning questions about what you've just seen? Non-burning questions are fine too. Yes?
That in that function, for your cost function, you had a undefined function tweak.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, I don't think that's anywhere in the notebook.
Is it, let me just go back and look at that function real quick. So when you say
vertical is not true.
Ah, yes, that's correct. So I was trying to make this as general as possible, and you're right. Vertical is not true.
Are you, you had it scroll up a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Right there. The
yes.
Line.
Mm-hmm. So the idea here is that you just, if it's the opposite orientation, if you're trying to do a panorama instead of this way, that framework would allow you to use essentially the exact same function, but just pass in the transpose of both with vertical equals, and I obviously need to change this because then the vertical, this would never stop, would it? Thank you. The idea was code reuse, so that you could use it in both orientations and just call the same function again with both transposed.
My question was, they're not named the same functions. The recursive call is going to, so.
Yeah, it's not recursive now.
Oh, it isn't? You're right. Thank you. Hold me to account. I'll push these changes back up. I appreciate that. Any other questions? Or fixes? All right, so then I think I'm going to hand it back over to Safan for a choose your own adventure section of the tutorial.
I've set up a few options here. I'm going to be going into the warping notebook now, but for those of you who are more interested in the biology side of things, maybe you want to look at how to analyze microarrays. So there's a whole problem set up for doing that. And then for those of you who feel that you need a bit of a challenge, I've set up a few exercises from, well, they're not exercises, they're just examples that I took straight from Stack Overflow. So people ask us questions on Stack Overflow about scikit-image, and I just grabbed a couple of the best examples I could find, popped them into a notebook. They're sort of in the form of problem solution. So just be careful that you don't read the solution if you don't want to see it beforehand. But I can show you roughly the kinds of things that you'll see there. So you know, people would ask, for example, how do I detect the tips of all the snakes in the image? Or how do you figure out where that pill is in the image? Can you find the outline of the pill? Or can you isolate the snowflake or the liquid flow? Or can you count coins? Or can you isolate certain parts of the balloon or the color wheel? Can you identify the coin and the hand separately in this image? Yeah, so those are the examples I have in there. For analyzing microarrays, I've got this example where it's just a slide. A scan. I don't know anything about this field technically, but I know this image can be analyzed. You can extract the red and the green parts of the image, and the red divided by the green, that ratio gives you some information that's useful scientifically. But it's a little bit tricky to figure out where are the dots. All the dots aren't perfectly round, so you must extract the dots and then kind of find the color ratio between the two, and then unpack that into a NumPy array. So that's roughly what that problem is about. But I would like to take you into the warping notebook now. And so I just mentioned to Josh, you know, that, so he just in an hour did panorama stitching with the scikit image. I worked for several months during my PhD to get code like that written to do panorama stitching. And it's wonderful that we now have the tools in the Python ecosystem to just do this in an hour and sort of understand what's happening there. The early on, I mentioned that we built scikit-image on top of SciPy's ndimage module. And one of the pieces of functionality I enjoy a lot is the warping functionality. So SciPy has warping in ndimage. I think it's called map coordinates or something like that. But it's kind of arcane and difficult to use. So we wrote very simple wrappers around it. And all that the wrapper requires is that you basically tell it, you get a bunch of input coordinates, x and y coordinates. You transform those coordinates, and once you've defined that transformation, scikit-image handles all the transformation in the background. So I'm going to skip down to the bottom of this. This is the warping notebook. It's linked from the index page. It's under lectures. It's called advanced4_warping. It's one of those that I added last night, so you might have to refresh your repository.
You can just run git pull.
Yeah. So I just scrolled down a little bit to the fisheye example, just to show you how easy it is to warp images in, with scikit-image. So I've got the standard import here at the top. I'm reading in an image. I didn't want to mess around with anyone else's face, so I just loaded my own. It's not a vanity thing. It's just so that I can mess around with it and not feel bad about it. And then I wanted to get the eye nicely in the middle of the image. So I just cropped the image a little bit so that my eye is right in the middle. Oh, I do. You're right. So right to the top, just execute that cell always. Perfect. Okay. Yeah, so there's the image. And I plotted the center of the image by just taking the shape, dividing it by two, and plotting those coordinates. Put a red dot down there. And now I want to transform this image. So like I said, it's as simple as defining a function. In this case, I call the function fisheye. It gets an array of x, y coordinates. It transforms those coordinates, and that transformation is sent to scikit-image. So in this case, the coordinate transformation is fairly simple. We calculate the center of the image. We call that xc and yc. Then we convert those coordinates to polar. And then I do some transformation on the polar coordinate. So I take the exponent and I multiply it by a factor here in front. And then I convert it back to xy coordinates. And when you execute that, okay, so now the fisheye function has been defined. You can have anything that takes the xy coordinate and modifies it. So you could, for example, just take the x coordinates and add one to it or multiply it by two or whatever you like. And then in scikit-image, there's a transform module. And the transform module has this warp function. And it takes as input the image, and then this transformation function. And that's all, that job done. So let's execute that, and then we just plot the original image and plot the transformed image. So let's see. So there we go. So what happens here in the background is that scikit-image goes across the whole image, generates all the coordinates, sends it to that fisheye module, and then my fisheye module transforms the coordinates, it goes back into scikit-image, and it warps the image for us. Right, so if you want to play around with coordinates of your own, just a little bit further down the notebook, I provided you with, where is it now? With a template for doing your own warp. So this whole cell defines a warp and executes it on that image and plots it. So. So in this case, you can see that the warp, I take the x and the y coordinates, and the x coordinate I simply modify by adding 1.5 times sine of the y coordinate over 3. And then you get this kind of ripple effect. So go ahead and feel free to play around and create your own transformations. But then I have a challenge for you guys. Where is it now? So I've put two scripts in the repository that you can play around with. The one is called dswirl, and the other one is called clock dblur. So I'll first run the clock dblur one. So what I did here is I took a webcam, and I stood in front of a wall clock, and I moved the webcam while I took a photo, and that blurred the clock. So I don't know, can anyone read the time on that clock as it is? Okay, that's good. So what I did then is I implemented an inverse transformation that deblurs the image, and the parameters you can set are these, T, A, B, and K. T is the exposure, that shouldn't matter much. K is like a constant amplification. Clipping is whether, if the inverse transformation generates values that are very high, then you can use it to clip it down. But the important parameters are A and B. That's basically the deblurring in the X and Y directions. So what I want you to do is play around with these parameters and see if you can figure out what the time on the clock is. You can see, like, if I play with a B parameter, I can very easily make the situation worse. But the question is, can you make it better? So that's the one challenge. But here's the real one. So if you run dswirl.py, you should see the Mona Lisa. And this example came from a real-world situation where there was a criminal in the UK that decided that it was a good idea to taunt the police by swirling up his face and posting pictures online. And he didn't realize that with a little bit of image processing, he might get caught, which he did in the end. So what I've done is I've implemented the swirl transform. It's given in the notebook if you want to look at the source code or look at the Python file if you want to see the source. And it takes the Mona Lisa face and it swirls it up. The parameters used to swirl the image are unknown to you. And the challenge I have for you is to try and reconstruct the original face by guessing these parameters and modifying them. The first parameter is the center of the transform. So you can click on this image and that will change the center of the twirl. Then the radius of the twirl can be set, and you can modify the strength as well. So, I don't know, that doesn't look very good. You can see on the side image that I'm not able to recover the face very well. Okay, so I'm happy to buy a beverage of choice for the person who gets the best version of the Mona Lisa back. Or translate to real world for the person who would do the sleuthing to find the criminal in the UK. All right, so that's challenge number two. And then for those of you who feel a little bit more adventurous, the third challenge would be to implement image rotation from scratch. So of course, it's already implemented in scikit-image. You can just, from the transform module, you can import transform.rotate, call it on your image, you're done. But the question is, what's happening underneath the hood there, and can you implement that algorithm yourself? So feel free to take any of the examples from the previous notebooks or to tackle any of these challenges, and remember to play around with the Mona Lisa example. I'd be happy to see what you come up with.
So the clock dblur requires Qt. What's the actual library?
The clock dblur one might rely on Qt, yes.
So like which, like how do you have to install, how do you install what?
PySide? Yeah.
Oh no, that you can install.
I think you can pip install PySide, yeah.
Okay.
But the dswirl one only relies on matplotlib, so you should be able to run that either way. Okay, so I'm going to give you about 15 minutes for that, and then we can just wrap up. So maybe just as a brainstorming session, if you were to implement your own image rotation from scratch, how do you think you would go about that? Right, so you start off, you figure out for every coordinate, you figure out what is its polar coordinate, and then say you want to rotate by 30 degrees, you've got the radius and the angle, and then you just add 30 degrees to the angle, and then you convert back to XY. So now you've got the original coordinate, and then you've got the new coordinate where you want that pixel to go. So that's the first step. Then what do you do with that information? So I guess the most intuitive thing to do is to say, well, I want this pixel at this position to go to this position in the output image. So you just take that value and you pop it in there. And you go over all your pixels and you copy them over. Right? So that's sort of the first thing you try, but that's a very bad idea. Why is that a bad idea? Well, let me show you. So if you implement that, oh, it's running. Oh, it just takes a while. It's slow. There we go. So I rotate the camera image, the cameraman image, and do you see there's a whole bunch of holes? So why did that happen? Yeah, exactly. So I do the coordinate transformation, but two points in my input sometimes fall on the same output coordinate. So then I take those two values, I override the same pixel on the output, but there are blank gaps in between that I never fill up. So what do you have to do to get what's exactly, yes. So the solution is not to start with the input and warp it to the output, but to start with your output image and to say, for this specific coordinate, where did it come from? And you do the inverse transformation, and now it would make sense to you why Josh earlier on, he specified the inverse transformation, because you want to know from your output image, how do I have to go back to the input image? So now you get a coordinate in the input image. And that coordinate is most likely not going to fall on an integer position, right? So it's going to fall between four different pixels. But we know what to do. When I give you four pixels and I say, give me the value in between them, what's the method we use for that? Average. It's called, the average or the interpolation, right? So we interpolate to find that specific position. We get the value, and we then put it in the output image. And so you scan your entire output image, go fetch the pixel values you need, and you place it in there. So that's sort of the purpose of this exercise, to figure out that whole concept. All right. Did anyone have any luck with the swirling the Mona Lisa? Okay. So maybe come and show me. I think we're going to wrap up now, but come and show me your best attempt, and I'll buy a beer or a drink for the person who got it right. So I guess that's it then. Anything else I should add?
Any other questions?
Yeah. Do you have any further questions? Any comments? Maybe about the bigger ecosystem or. Yeah.
Just to clarify, I thought I heard someone say that they would be updating some of these, and so we can do a pull request later. Is that
right? Yeah. So we will be we fixed a couple of small things, and he did a whole bunch of coding. Brave man. So we'll be putting those changes back into the Git repository. So if you do a pull tomorrow, they should be there for you.
There's also a solution subdirectory. So there's lectures, and then inside lectures there are solutions. And the solution notebooks should have the gaps filled in. A couple of them are a little rough around the edges, but we'll be fixing that too.
Any other questions? Right, so if you want to get hold of us, we're available on the scikit-image mailing list. There's a chat room on Gitter. It's linked from the index page. We track issues on the GitHub site. And of course, grab us anytime during the conference. We're happy to sit down with you and help you with any image processing related problems you may have. And then please join us for the sprints on Sunday. I'd be happy to have anyone there who's interested in contributing. Like I say, documentation, website, coding, we can use help in many different ways. So thanks for your time and attention. Appreciate it.